I'm Stewart Patrick. On this installment of The Internationalist, we'll explore the renaissance of a much maligned institution, the UN Human Rights Council. Once dismissed as useless, the Council has made important strides over the past 2 years and is at last beginning to live up to some of its responsibilities, thanks in part to vigorous U.S. diplomacy. So here are five things you need to know about the Human Rights Council. First, the Human Rights Council was established in 2006 to replace its dysfunctional predecessor, the UN Commission on Human Rights, which had become a haven for human rights abusers and an embarrassment to the entire United Nations system. The nadir actually came in 2003 when Libya was elected chair of the group and Sudan as a member, even as Khartoum was beginning its campaign of genocide in Darfur. When the new council was created, the administration of George W. Bush chose not to join it, doubting it would be any improvement. President Obama then reverse-coursed, reasoning that it was important to engage the body from within rather than allowing human rights violators and spoilers from Cuba to Pakistan to run roughshod over it. The United States was elected to a seat on the council in 2009 and has served on it ever since. The second thing is that the council still suffers from some pretty significant flaws. To begin with, it's only a bit smaller than its unwieldy predecessor, with 47 rather than 53 members. It also lacks rigorous membership criteria. It's dominated by block voting based on outdated ideologies and regional affiliations. And the council is generally reluctant to adopt hard-hitting, country-specific resolutions against human rights abusers. Even its democracies lack the political courage often to defend freedom. To make matters worse, the council's members themselves are often divided on the relative importance of civil and political rights on the one hand, and economic, social, and cultural rights on the other. Finally, the council retains an exaggerated focus on Israel, often ignoring much worse abuses elsewhere. Third, despite these weaknesses, the council has some clear advantages over the commission. The most important may be its system of so-called universal periodic review. Every few years, every single member of the council, including the United States, opens itself up to international scrutiny of its human rights record. UPR, as it's called, has been a powerful instrument, shedding light on human rights shortcomings in despotic regimes like Iran and Zimbabwe. The council can also appoint special rapporteurs to investigate human rights conditions in specific member countries. Even in authoritarian states, these rapporteurs offer a lifeline to local non-governmental organizations defending human rights. The fourth point is a little-known fact. Although it's commonly overlooked, the council has an institutional advantage over the commission. It limits member states to 2 consecutive terms. Within the hapless commission, the worst rights abusers could fester on that body for decades. But that's no longer the case. In 2012, many countries with less than stellar human rights records, say Saudi Arabia, Russia, and China, will see their second terms expire and will take a time out from the council. Fifth, U.S. leadership has really paid off. Over the last 2 years, the United States has scored some impressive wins through vigorous diplomacy, both in Geneva and in national capitals. These achievements include the appointment of the first special rapporteur on Iran. The council has also passed 2 resolutions that unequivocally condemn the violence in Syria and has established a commission of inquiry for that country, with strong support even among Arab states. By contrast, the UN Security Council has yet to pass a single resolution on Syria. The council was also in the lead in confronting Muammar Gaddafi, passing a consensus resolution critical of the Libyan regime in late February 2011, and actually ejected the one-time chair from council membership. The Obama administration has also scored victories on some important thematic resolutions. It sponsored the first ever resolution on lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender rights, and it crafted a compromise resolution on the controversial issue of defamation of religion. one that upheld the principle of freedom of speech. Here's what I'd like you to consider. Can positive momentum on the Human Rights Commission be sustained? My own view is that further progress within the Council is possible, but only through active U.S. political leadership and support. Without U.S. participation and focus, the Council is apt to retreat to its former vices, including focusing obsessively on Israel, terminating country-specific mandates, and turning a blind eye to major human rights developments around the world. That's my assessment. What do you think? Join the debate on the Internationalist blog at cfr.org.